Jesus promises us that not only our names will be written in His book of life, but Jesus also promises us an inheritance, a spiritual inheritance. So Pastor David Lilly, coming to you from Big Valley, Alberta, with another Bible teaching. And today we're going to look at the subject, the book of life, the book of life. We're going to begin with a reading from Scripture found in Revelation chapter 20, beginning with verse 11. "And I saw a great white throne, and Him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." Here ends the reading of God's holy word. I want to talk to you today about a very serious matter, and that is having the assurance. Do you have the assurance that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life? I want to share with you how to be certain. In John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 3, it says, "We must be born again from above." This is the answer that Jesus gave to a very religious man named Nicodemus. He was a Pharisee. He was one who was an expert in all things concerning the law. And yet, deep down inside, there was something missing. He didn't have peace. He didn't have the assurance that all was well with God. And so, coming late at night to see Jesus so that no one could identify him as a follower of Jesus, he came to Jesus, recognizing that Jesus was a great teacher. He called him Rabbi. And he said, "Rabbi, what must I do to be saved?" And Jesus said those words, "You must be born from above." Having that assurance is as easy as ABC. And so, first of all, we need to admit that we are sinners. B, we need to believe that Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. And then C, we need to confess with our mouths that Jesus Christ is Savior and Lord. It's as simple as ABC. Some mistakenly believe that these steps are too simple. But believe me, they are not. We all need God's help in order to make a true profession of faith. We also need God's help in repenting or turning away from our sins in order to go in a new direction. The Bible says, "To as many as believed in Him, He gave them power to become the sons of God." Like Joseph in the Old Testament, who fled the very appearance of evil, we must train our ears and our eyes and our hearts to flee from anything that is sinful. Remember again Jesus' words to the woman taken in adultery, "Woman, your sins are forgiven." Now go and sin no more. Almost 40 years ago, Jesus Christ came into my life to be my Savior and Lord and to set me free from the sinful things that were destroying my life. It's not always been easy. It's a difficult thing to take your stand for Jesus Christ when many others turn away from Him.
Jesus said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it."
Jesus said that there are two ways, two roads in this world. There's a broad road that leads to destruction. It's the road that everybody's traveling. It'll get you to places you've always dreamt of. But those places will lead ultimately to destruction and the ruination of the soul. And then Jesus said there was another road, a narrow road. A road that had many turns and many detours, many potholes. Not too many people travel that road. And yet Jesus said that if we would remain faithful and we would keep on traveling down this road, it would lead us to heaven, to eternal life. I want to challenge each one of us to keep our eyes on Jesus, to keep on the road that will lead us to eternal life. Jesus promises us that not only our names will be written in His book of life, but Jesus also promises us an inheritance, a spiritual inheritance that we can only dream of. One that will never waste away. One that no thief can steal from us or take away from us. But it's an inheritance that will be for all eternity. We look around today. It's a beautiful day. The sun is shining. And we have many flowers in this garden. This is a very scenic spot in which to have this final Bible study. And even as we look at this mural behind me, we see a peaceful, very peaceful, tranquil image of a teepee village. And I can only imagine that 150 years ago in this village, in this valley, this was a peaceful place to come. And yet this is nothing. This is a garbage can compared to what God has for us. If we'll put our faith and trust in Him, if we'll set out on the narrow road and follow Him no matter what. I'm reminded of the old book, Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan long ago. And it tells the story of Christian who one day is shown in a book that God is going to judge his city. And yet God, who is a God of love, gives him a warning. He tells him to flee the city of destruction. And so even though his wife and his family turn on him, in fact, they make fun of him, Christian makes the decision to set out for the celestial city that is revealed in this book. And along the way, there are many detours. He encounters many colorful characters. And some of them are there to help him. But there are others there to distract him and lead him in the wrong direction. And so evangelist comes and reminds him of God's promises, and God sends others to help him as he journeys toward that celestial city. Along the way, he reaches Mount Calvary, and all this time he's been carrying a backpack on his shoulders. It was filled with the burdens, the burden of his sins. And once he arrived to Mount Calvary, he was instructed to leave those burdens at the foot of the cross, because there he met Jesus. There he met the Master. There his name was recorded in the book of life. That was not the end of his journey. That was only a new beginning. There were many perils, many more perils along the way. But ultimately, Pilgrim makes his way to the celestial city, to heaven's gates. And the Good Shepherd, the one who cares for our souls, makes good with his promise, opens heaven's gates and welcomes Christian in. This is the story of the Pilgrim's Progress. I want to challenge each of us to become pilgrims today. There are going to be times when the going's going to get tough. You're going to feel that everyone has abandoned you. But know that God has not abandoned you. Jesus said, "I will never leave you or forsake you. Lo, I will be with you always, even until the end of the age." May God bless this Bible teaching in the name of Jesus Christ, the name which is above all names. Amen.